So this morning, I would like to talk something that it is very difficult for you to understand and difficult to answer if anybody asks this question. But is that, where is the Buddha today? Where did he go? Is there anybody who can answer this question? Because we consider in worldly way of life. Now that is why it is difficult for us to answer. And the other religions, they try to introduce the God. God is living. God can bless you, protect you, send you to heaven. So God is living. When they approach the Buddhists, they say, the Buddha is not a God. He was a man. He is dead and gone. What do you gain by worshipping and praying and offering? Also, Buddhists do not know how to answer this question. This concept of God actually created by the human mind. One professor in America, he has written, first, man created the God. Later, they started to tell God creates the man. What is the meaning of this? Scientists say it has taken millions of years for us to develop our mind, our understanding. So, when our mind is developing and developing and developing, we came to know there are some sort of energies that we cannot understand. Then they had to think there must be a person to create, to maintain these energies. That is how they have personified or introduced as a figure all these energies. So it is a concept created by the human mind. It is important for our human mind because we have no confidence. Always we have fear, worries, suspicion, insecurity. Therefore, we need somebody to depend on. Therefore, people are very keen to believe in God, to depend on them for their protection, for their salvation. From the Buddhist point of view, when we analyze, the Buddha never introduced him as a son of God or messenger of God, but as an enlightened person. Buddha was not an incarnation of another Buddha. According to Hinduism, all those who appeared are the incarnations of the same God. Buddha is not created by another Buddha. So Buddha is not the reincarnation of another Buddha. Individual person, by working such a long period, life after life, life after life, by developing, cultivating all the great qualities, virtues, paramitas, perfection, when he developed up to the max maximum level, he gained enlightenment. Then people ask, how do we gain enlightenment? There must be somebody to give our enlightenment. And these are the things that people cannot understand. Individually, we develop our mind to understand things. I have mentioned the meaning of the word that we always use, why we are called manushya. In many languages, they use this word, human being. Why we are called manushya? Mana means mind. Manusya means one who can develop, cultivate the mind up to maximum level. There is, you know, another living being in this universe who can develop the mind up to that extent to gain enlightenment. God cannot become a Buddha. Brahma or divine beings cannot become the Buddha because they do not develop their enlightenment. They have worldly, sensual, peaceful, prosperous life. But enlightenment is very poor. Only manushya, only human being can become the Buddha or enlightenment. When people say, Buddha is not a god, he is a man, we should not try to show, no, he is a god. Real validity of the enlightenment we reduce if we try to introduce the Buddha as a god. Again, those who talk about God, there is nobody in this world who has seen the God. That is concept. They say God has given a message to humanity. If it is for the whole human beings in this world, why the God wanted to hide and come and reveal only to one man? What is the difficulty for him to appear and announce, this is for you, then everybody accept. Always they say, God revealed secretly and they come and announce, God says like this. So after creating concept and belief and understanding according to their way of thinking at that time, they have returned all the holy books, saying God has given this message. Today, scientists discard and show the disagreement, conflicts, clashes between the scientific discoveries and what is written in the holy book. Because scientists have developed their mind without depending on God, without depending on religion, by using their independent intelligence. Therefore, we cannot say that they are wrong. They have enough evidence to prove. But in religion, we had to believe. Whether we can understand or not, we had to believe. The Buddha did not encourage anybody to believe anything. I remember one day, a Christian priest came here with his followers to discuss about Buddhism. in the end, he asked, actually, can you tell me what Buddhists believe? Then I told him, tell you very frankly, Buddhists do not believe anything. He got a shock. He has seen my book that I have written, What Buddhists Believe. Then he asked, why did you write this book? That is why I wrote this book. You can read whether there is anything for you to believe. Nothing. Then he asked, then can you tell me what they are doing? Ah, very good. Buddha has given the answer. Buddha has advised us what to do instead of believing. Pariyatti, Patipatti, Pativeda. There are three things. First, we must try to understand. Not to believe. You can believe anything that you can understand. You do not know whether true or not. The Buddha says, you must try to understand. Now you are here to understand, to learn something. That is the first item, learning. Try to understand. In his teaching, in the Eighth Noble Path, the first item, Sammaditti, right understanding. So Buddha started his mission with right understanding, not with belief. Then, after learning, we have wonderful knowledge about Buddha and Buddhism. If we keep quiet, there is no meaning. We had to practice what we have learned. Because he has pointed out, these are the things that you have to do. These are the things that you should do. These are the morals and immorals and useful and useless things. Then now we understood. Otherwise, we create our own imagination. All over the world, people maintain their own imagination. So his advice was to practice what you have learned. After practicing, you experience the result or the effect. Then you come to know, oh yes, it is true, these are the things that we should not do, these are the things that we must do, this is the way how to live in this world, this is the way how to get rid of our suffering, through understanding. Now you can understand, the Buddha's way of introducing religion is not for us to believe anything, but to learn and understand, practice, experience. Take for instance, he says, you must be kind. You must be honest. You learn. After learning, you tried to practice. You are very kind. You are very honest. Everybody respects you when they come to know you are very kind, very honest. Nobody wants to disturb you, accuse you, blame you, but respect you. That is the good result you experience. On the other hand, the Buddha says, according to your own experience, you can understand why these things are wrong, why these things are right. Not because the order, the commandment, religious laws given by the Buddha or God or anybody. You also have a thinking mind to understand. Your own experience is enough. Why this is wrong, why this is right. to understand. Example, attanam upamankattva nahaneyena gate. He advises us not to destroy other living beings. He did not introduce religious law or commandment. He advised. That is his way of preaching. He advised us not to kill others. Then he says, if it is difficult for you to understand why it is bad, then when another person comes and tries to kill you, how do you feel? That experience is more than enough for you to understand why it is bad. Again he says, you have lost your valuable thing stolen by somebody. How do you feel? When you go and steal others' property, they also get the same feeling that you had. Not necessary to get order from God or Buddha or Jesus or anybody. Your own experience is more than enough for you to know why these things are right, why these things are wrong. Another important point. All the other religions advise their followers to believe something. The Buddha did not ask us to believe anything, but to think and understand. Vast difference, belief and thinking and understanding. So we have thinking mind. We have sense of reasoning. We have common sense. But other living beings, although they have mind, they have no thinking mind. Their minds are limited to find out their food, their lodging, their shelter, their protection. They cannot extend their mind further. But human beings have a mind to think and understand up to the maximum level. Now we can understand up to what extent the scientists have gone in searching many things which we never heard. There is no another living being in this world who can develop the mind up to that extent. That is why only human beings can become a Buddha by developing this mind, gain the enlightenment. Then we accept what he preach, what he tell us to do or not to do, according to our experience. So there are no belief in Buddhism. Now, topic is what to say if anybody asks, where is the Buddha? Have you got anything to say? Can you say he is in heaven or he is in Nirvana, he is in somewhere else? Where did he go? These two questions are wrong. From worldly point of view, we ask these two questions. After gaining enlightenment, Buddha says, Ayamanti majati natthi dani punabhau. This is my last birth, Ayamanti Majati. Natthi dani punabhavo. No more becoming again, no more rebirth again. I already stopped. Because existence here in this world. Life after life, birth and death, birth and death, birth and death continue. Within this period, physically and mentally, enormous sufferings and worries and problems and pains and difficulties and calamities we are experiencing in our mind, physically and mentally. There is nobody in this world who can satisfy with this life. Everybody complain, grumble about physically or mentally. By knowing this situation, I could manage to stop rebirth. That is called salvation. Salvation means freedom from physical and mental suffering. By existing in physical form or any other living beings, we cannot stop our physical and mental suffering. So, if we don't like to suffer, best thing is to stop this. But our craving is so strong, our attachment is so strong in our mind, we are not willing to give up hopes. We want to exist in spite of all sorts of sufferings and troubles and pain and sicknesses and problems. That is our ignorance. Because of our ignorance, we cannot understand our craving is the main cause of all our suffering. Now look at what is happening in this world. Whole world is a battlefield. All over the world, people create violence and bloodshed and war and killing and disturbing. Why? Animals are living without creating all those unnecessary problems and troubles. When they are hungry, they go on catch another living being and get satisfied and go and sleep. But human beings cannot satisfy with that. Craving, attachment is so advanced in our human mind, then we develop jealousy and enmity, anger, ill will, cruelty, wickedness develop. In other living beings, they do not develop the mind up to that extent. Religion is not for us to worship and pray and do some offering. They are devotional aspect of religion. We have started. It is important for us, but the Buddha did not advise anybody to come and worship him. When he was about to pass away, so many people assembled with flowers to offer and pay respect, having heard that he is going to pass away. His disciple Ananda was struck. This is not the time to disturb the Buddha. The Buddha overheard. Then asked Ananda, what is happening? He said, there are many people who have assembled to pay their last respect before you passing away. Then the Buddha says, ask them to go back. If they really want to respect the Buddha, instead of offering flowers, instead of worshipping, ask them to practice at least one advice given by the Buddha. Then they really respect the Buddha. Now you can understand what the Buddha wanted. not for us to pray or worship or do some offering, but to follow some advices given by him. Again, one of the disciples called Bakkula, the monk, every day he come and sit down in front of the Buddha and watch. One day, the Buddha asked Bakkula, "What are you doing here?" Then he said, "When I look at your physical body, it gives me a lot of happiness. I really experience wonderful happiness." Then the Buddha says, "Kinte vakkali imina putikayana duggandena sarire." Vakkali, by watching this dirty, filthy, impermanent physical body, what do you gain? You entertain your emotion. You never gain knowledge, understanding, but entertain your emotion. You cannot see the real Buddha through the physical body. Buddha is not the physical body. Then he said, "Yo dhammang passati, so mang passati." One who understood the Dhamma taught by the Buddha, through this Dharma, he can see the real Buddha. Real Buddha appears in the mind when we understood what the Buddha taught. Here you can understand. Buddha was not particular about the physical body. When you study history of India, for nearly 500 years, they never had any Buddha image in India. Because Buddha did not encourage anybody to create, erect images. During the Greek occupation, they are the ones who have introduced images, symbols, and all sorts of things. Now spreading all over the world, different forms of figures as Buddha, belly Buddha, laughing Buddha. This is our imagination. So, image is not the important thing. Now, Muslims and some others condemn us as idol worshippers. I used to go to Islamic University and I told them, "You condemn us saying we are idol worshippers." Actually, Buddhists are not idol worshippers. They do not worship idols. That is a very good parable. 200 years after the Buddha, there was a well-known monk called Upagupta. He's a very popular. When he gave talk, thousands of people assembled. You know Mara. In every religion, there's a very strong opponent. Christianity and Islam, Satan. Hinduism, Asura. Buddhism, Mara, disturb. So Mara was watching. He was very unhappy because more and more people become religious. What he did, he started to perform very attractive entertainment, dancing, singing, merrymaking in front of the temple. Then the devotees slowly turned toward the other side. There was nobody to come and listen to his talk. Then Upagupta thought. No doubt he disturbed the Buddha, but the Buddha did not teach him a good lesson. I must teach him a good lesson. He also went there. When the performance was finished, he said, "Yes, we really appreciate your performance. In appreciation of your performance, I would like to put a garland on your neck." Oh, he was very proud. He put a garland. Then he noticed this garland is tightening, tightening like pythons in his neck. He tried to pull it out, cannot take it back. Then he went to the Sakra, the king of the god, asked him to help him. He also tried and tried. He said, "I'm sorry, sorry, I cannot do that." Then he went to Brahma, the creator god at that time, asked him to remove this one. He also tried, could not take it. Then he told him, "The one who put this garland is the only one who can take it out. Another one cannot." Then he had to come back. Come back and ask, "Venerable Upagupta, please take out this garland from my neck. I am going to die." Then Upagupta said, "All right. Under two conditions. First thing, you must promise in future you are not going to disturb any religious services." Mara said, "Yes." "Second thing, you have seen the Buddha, because there were many occasions he disturbed the Buddha. You got the supernatural power to transform the physical body and represent as the Buddha. If you promise that you appear as the real Buddha figure, then I will take it out." He said, "Yes, I can do that." Then he took out. Then Mara said, "When I appeared as the Buddha, you should not worship me, because I am not a holy man." Then Venerable Upagupta said, "No, I am not going to worship you." Then he appeared as real Buddha. Then he paid respect. Then Mara shouted, "You promise that you are not going to worship me." Then Upagupta said, "I did not worship you, I worship the Buddha." This is a very good example for you to tell others. When you keep a Buddha image, pay homage, pay respect, take for meditation, but you are not worshipping the idols. You invite the Buddha into your mind through this symbol. It is a symbol and very attractive. During the Second World War, Burmese in Burma, a general in army, found a very beautiful Buddha image. He was not a Buddhist. He sent this to England, to Winston Churchill, the Prime Minister of England at that time, with a note: "Please keep this image on your table. Every time, whenever you have some worries and troubles and problems, look at his face. You can forget your worries." They were not Buddhists. Again, Anatole France, French scholar, first time he has seen the Buddha image, in museum, when he has sinned, if God has come down from heaven and walked on this earth, he is none other than this appeal to his mind, his figure. Mr. Nehru, the former Prime Minister of India, he was not a Buddhist. He was arrested by the British government for fighting for independence. When he was in the jail, he had a small Buddha image in his pocket. He kept the Buddha image on the table and watched. In spite of all these troubles, problems, difficulties, the Buddha could manage to maintain a smiling face. You cannot see the sour face of the Buddha. Why not we follow him? No doubt we have a lot of problems and troubles and disturbances. Why not we follow him? This is the way how they appreciate. This is the way how they make use of the image. Therefore, we cannot say it is wrong, it is important. But there are many who can practice the teachings of the Buddha without an image. It is not compulsory that you must have an image. So, I told those students in Islamic University, you condemn us by giving wrong interpretation that we are idol worshippers. We don't worship, we don't pray, we don't ask anything from the images. But we pay homage, we respect. This is the symbol. One of our members, who have been keeping a Buddha image of 45 years in his house, one day, came and told me, do you know a group of Christian missionaries enter into my house and they told me I am worshipping a devil. Actually, I do not know what to say. 45 years he has been worshipping and he does not know what he was doing. Then he came and told me. And this is the mentality of our Buddhists. They follow traditional worshipping, praying, offering, chanting, but they do not try to understand what the Buddha taught. Then, now you can understand, with or without the Buddha image, we can practice the teachings of the Buddha. So, physical body is not the Buddha. According to Mahayana schools of Buddhism, they introduced three bodies of the Buddha. Three kaya, three bodies. Sambhoga kaya, Nirmana kaya, Dharma kaya. Three bodies. Although he had three bodies, he was not a physical body. He was not a busy body. Sambhogakaya Nirmanakaya, he used for eating, sleeping, walking, talking, advising, preaching, for all these activities, he used these physical bodies. When the Buddha attained Parinirvana, all these two bodies disappear. But Dharma Kaya, Dharma body of the Buddha never disappeared. They try to show Buddha did not die. His Dharma body is existing. They follow the teachings of the Buddha. He has mentioned, whether the Buddhas appear or not, Dharma exists forever in this world. When a Buddha appeared, he realized, understand the Dharma that people have forgotten. It is mentioned, Pāturahose magadesu bubbe dhammo asuddho samalejitita. This Dharma that I understood is not a new Dharma, not created by me. This Dharma existed long ago, but people have misinterpreted, created wrong concept, wrong belief, their own imagination, completely polluted the purity of the Dharma. It is happening today. 2500 years ago, the Buddha has revealed the truth as Dharma. When you see what people are doing in China, Japan, Korea, Mongolia, Tibet, Sri Lanka, Thailand, Burma, and all those countries, what they are doing in the name of Buddhism, in the name of the Buddha. It is not that really they follow the advice given by the Buddha. Their traditional, cultural belief they have been maintaining, incorporated with Buddhism and today introduced as Buddhism. Anyway, that is not so important. We should not bother about Theravada, Mahayana, Vajrayana. One should not say, I am Theravada, I am Mahayana, I am Vajrayana. Buddha was not belong to any of these jhanas. We follow the teachings of the Buddha. You can use any label. It is not important. We are Buddhists. We are followers of the Buddha. We try to learn what the Buddha taught. We try to practice what the Buddha taught to find out our salvation. Then people ask, actually where he is? People cannot understand, cannot answer. To practice Buddhism, it is not necessary for us to know where the Buddha is, where he did go. Take for instance, we have electricity discovered by somebody. Is it necessary for us to know the person who discovered electricity, where he is and where, from which country and his name? Is it necessary? Our duty is to make use of electricity. That person is not important. Again, those who have discovered atomic energy, they can use this atomic energy for constructive or destructive purpose. So it is our duty to make use of this energy. Not necessary to know actually who discovered this atomic energy. Again, we have telephone, television, so many things discovered by different people. Not necessary for us to know the names and the details, where they are, what happened to them, but our duty is to use this thing. Again, one who discovered gravity. One day, I forgot his name, when he was sitting under an apple tree, one apple dropped. Then he started to think, why everything dropped here instead of going up? Then he started to investigate, found out. There is some sort of energy which is called gravity, pull down, but into certain extent. In the space, there are many places, area, there is no gravity. If you carry huge stone and drop there, the stone is floating here and there, cannot drop, because there is no gravity. And those who have landed on the moon, they knew there is no gravity, no living beings. What they did, they fixed some sort of machine here to raise the hand, and machines here to use the leg here and there. Otherwise, they cannot move their leg and hand. No gravity. But here, we have this gravity. And we know, when you climbed, be careful not to drop. Otherwise, we may die. So we learn something. Is it necessary for us to know the name of this person and who discovered this, when he discovered this gravity? Here, more than enough for you to understand. Without asking where the Buddha is, where he did go, we can, if the Dharma is available, what he taught, that is enough for us. No need to depend on Buddha. Buddha never promised to send you to heaven or nirvana. Buddha says, Tummehi kichang atappang akkataro tathagata. The Buddha can tell you what to do and what not to do. That is the only thing Buddha can do. He cannot do anything for you. Others say, God can wash away the sins committed by people. Buddha never said, sins created by one person, another person can wash away. Buddha or God or anybody. When a person is going to die, he has done lot of criminal, wicked, cruel, dangerous, harmful thing. But when he is going to die, he say, I believe in God, please take away my sins. Then the God run away and wash away the sin and send him to heaven. People believe this. Take for instance, and you are very hot tempered. You know it is wrong, but you do not know how to get rid of this. Then you go to God and pray and ask, please take away my cruelty from my mind. Do you think God can do that? If not, you come to the Buddha and worship and ask the Buddha, please take away my anger from my mind. Doubly. No one can do that, but you can do that. How? Through understanding. This anger is dangerous. Can create a lot of troubles and problems and difficulties among ourselves and harm and disturb others. Why not I try to reduce and reduce and reduce? By using your strong determination, you can reduce it. The Buddha cannot reduce this. So, washing away the sins committed by us, the Buddha cannot do that. God cannot do that. Please remember. But we can do that. How? Tummehi punyang ekech buddhaṃ saraṇaṃ gatāte nate gamissanti appāyaṃ. In one of the sutras, he says, when a person is going to die, although he has committed a lot of bad things, if he can invite the Buddha into his mind, Buddhaṃ saraṇaṃ gacchāmi. If he died while holding this in his mind, existence never take place in a bad state. Because last thought moment was the Buddha in his mind. For a certain period, he can spend there, but not forever. But he can wash away the sins committed by him. Again, the Buddha says, Yassa papaṃ kataṃ kammaṃ kusaleṇa pitiyate. This is a very good advice. If anyone has committed bad deeds, bad karma, by praying to God or Buddha, they cannot get rid of the bad thing, evil deed, bad karma. But you can do that. How? When you come to know that I have committed lot of bad deeds, wicked, cruel thing, I stop. In future, I am not going to commit this kind of bad thing. Then create strong determination in your mind. From today onward, I create more and more kusala karma. Kusaleena pitiyati. So when you develop your kusala karma, the effect of the bad karma that you have committed earlier can overcome. Before those effects come, the effect of the good deeds come to us. Take for instance, Angulimala, murderer, who killed nearly 1,000 human beings, the Buddha, when he come to know, he went to see. He wanted to kill the Buddha because he has completed 999. His vow was to kill 1,000. So he was very happy when he saw the Buddha and tried to catch him. Occasionally, the Buddha performed a little bit of miracle. By knowing it is difficult to control this man, what the Buddha did, he walked in normal way and allow him to run nearly 4 miles. He cannot come nearer the Buddha. Then he says, stop. Then the Buddha knew the time for me to talk to him. Buddha said, I have already stopped. You are the one who runs. Then he said, how can you say you have stopped? I saw you are walking. I have stopped mean I have stopped killing, destroying other living beings. You are the one who runs means you do that. Then he asked, all right, I know you did not run, you walk, but I run nearly 4 miles. Why I could not catch you? Then the Buddha said, you could not catch me because you run. You stop your running, then you can catch me. Then he said, I cannot understand this. Then the Buddha said, I have stopped killing and you are doing, that means running. Then he came to know that he is wrong. Decided to follow the Buddha, become a monk, started to meditate, attain arahantahood, after that attain nirvana. Bad karma had no chance to come and catch him. He went on developing good karma, so the bad karma had no chance to affect him. That is what the Buddha says. This is the method taught by the Buddha. not by praying to any god or Buddha or Bodhisattvas or God, but by doing more and more kusala karma. Again, kusala karma, punya karma, there are two words. They have mixed up these two things. When he was practicing self-torturing, without eating, without sleeping, without resting in the jungle, Mara appeared again. He told him, "You are a young prince. Why do you want to suffer like this? Why need to go back? Enjoy your life. You will be the ruler of this country. If you want, you can create some punya karma also." Then the Buddha said, "Anumattena pi punyena atto maiham na vijyati." I am not working to create punya karma, meritorious deeds. What is that? We do lot of good deeds, offering dana, charity and various other things, expecting something in return. Either to be born in rich family or to go to heaven and enjoy your life, that is called punya karma. We gain what we wanted, but there's a limited period for that. When that karmic energy is ended, we don't know what to do. This is the nature of punya karma. Now take for instance, you are very fortunate. Compare with many others. In millions, many people are dying without food, without anything, no shelter throughout their life. They are suffering. But we are very fortunate. We have shelter, we have food, we have clothing. What is the reason? If God creates all these human beings, why He created those millions of humans to suffer? Is it not His duty to provide food and lodging and everything what they need? Otherwise, what is the meaning of creation? They were not created by anybody. They have not accumulated enough good karma to spend in the next existence. That is why they suffer. In your case, you have done lot of meritorious deeds. So you are not blind or deaf or crippled or mad, or you are normal. And you have enough food, clothing, shelter. But compare with many others in many countries, millions of people are suffering. That means they have not accumulated enough good karma when rebirth takes place to continue their way of life. It's very easy to understand. So if we enjoy our life, by spending all the good karma that we have done during our previous birth without creating fresh or new karma within this lifetime, same thing will happen to us. Human beings are the only living beings who can understand this. This is not the first and the last life. After our death, existence again takes place. Therefore, it is our duty to prepare for the next existence while we are here. You can enjoy your life by spending all the good deeds that you have done during your previous birth. Then what will happen to you after your death? If you have not accumulated enough good merit, enough good karma within this lifetime, your life again will drop. Only human beings can understand this. Devas, Brahmas, divine beings, animals, other living beings cannot understand. They spend their good karma and bad karma. When their karma are ended, they don't know what will happen to them. Now, Devas enjoyed their life in heaven. They think it is permanent. There is nothing permanent here in this universe. There is a limited period for them to enjoy their life. But while they are enjoying, they do not accumulate good merit. Then what will happen to them? When the good karmas are ended, again they will drop. But as human beings, we can understand. We are experiencing peaceful, happy, prosperous life because we have done good karma during our previous birth. Therefore, it is our duty to prepare for the next existence while we are living here by doing some meritorious deed. Not only spending the merit that we have created during the last birth. Please remember. More than an hour. But there are many things for you to think, to understand.
Yes, this is a question answer session now. Any questions to ask Chief Reverend? First volunteer to ask questions. Any questions?
Recently we had inter-religious gathering. A lot of educated people were there. Somebody asked, what is the difference between Jesus and the Buddha? Then I thought, if I am going to explain item by item, there is no end. I told them, the Buddha was not a Buddhist. Jesus was not a Christian. They were religious teachers. These names given by us, they were religious teachers. Our discriminations depend on our religious labels, not on religious principle. Take for instance, Islam preaches 5 pillars. Belief in God, fasting, and praying, charity, pilgrimage. These 5 things must be completed by every Muslim. Let us take Buddhism. Buddhism teaches not to kill, not to steal, not to commit adultery or sexual misconduct, or not to tell lies, not to take intoxicating drinks and drugs. Is there anybody in this world who can say there is something wrong in Buddhism? Christianity, they have 10 commandments. When you study, there is nothing for us to tell that they are wrong. Again, Hinduism. In Hinduism, they have Brahmacharya, Ahimsa, non-violence. 3 basic principles. Brahmacharya, noble way of life. Ahimsa, non-violence, and truthfulness, honesty. Is there anyone who can say they are wrong? They are the basic religious principles. So if we practice these religious principles, There is no controversy, there is no jealousy, not necessary to convert. In my booklet, Buddhist Attitude Toward Other Religions, I have written there. Instead of converting others into Buddhism, we can encourage them to practice their own religion. But others cannot say. They say we are sinners. They say we go to hell. Because these religious labels. But when you consider the basic principles, we can agree. No reason to discriminate or show our hostility, discrimination. Many people never realize. Superiority, inferiority complex, they maintain because of label. Buddhism, Christianity, Islam, Hinduism. Take out this label. Take only religion. In our religion, these are the principles. In our religion, these are the principles. Not necessary to have a label. They are fighting to convert, bring others in to give new label. It's called conversion. Please remember this. Not necessary. Okay.
Okay, since there's no questions, we would like to do the transfer of merits, share the transfer of merits, which is done by Chief Reverend. Before that, can we have a big sadhu for Chief Reverend? Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu.
Can you recite? Stand up. Himina punya kammena upajjaya gunottara acari upakaraca mata pita piya mamang suriyo chandi maharaja gunavanta narapiche Brahma Maharaja Indaja Lokapala Devata Yamo Mitta Manusaja Majjata Verikapija Sabbe Satta Dukkhivantu Punyani Pakatani Me Sukhañca tividaṃ dentu kippaṃ pāpeta omataṃ imina puñña kammena imina uddiseṇa ca kippāhaṃ sulabbe ceva tanno upādāna cedanaṃ Ye santa ne na dhamma yava nibbana to mamang nasantu labbadayeva yatta jato bhave bhave uju citto satipanyo salleko Mara labhantu no kāsaṁ kātuncha viriyesuve buddhā dīpavaro nāto dhammo nāto varuttamo nāto pacchekaṁ buddho saṅgho nāto taro mama Tezottamanubhavena Maroka Sangrabhantuma Blessing. Bhavatu sabba mangalam rakkhantu sabba devata Sabba buddhāna bhāvena sadā sutti vāntutte Bhavatu sabba mangalaṁ rakkhantu sabba devatā Sabba dhammāna bhāvena sadā sutti vāntutte Bhavatu sabba mangalaṁ rakkhantu sabba devatā Sabba sanghānu bhāvena sadā sutti vāntutte So today is the last day of your Chinese New Year. So by the blessings of the Buddha, Dhamma and Sangha, we hope you'll be able to lead a peaceful, happy, prosperous life by the blessings of the Buddha. Thank you very much.